So that's it. Here we are. Last lecture, final lecture, plus one, a little one where I will try to make a summary and give you a foretaste of what's coming in the next semester. But as far as the main module of the course is concerned, the main curriculum, we are complete. That is when we will have seen today's topic, which is about Jacobians. So what is a Jacobian? Let us start without any further delay. This is the extension, the generalization of the concept of derivative to function of several variables. We've seen already function of several variables, but we are focused to the case of linear function, which means the one that were basically matrices. I'll be working in the space Rn and Rm instead of the abstract vector space, Hilbert space, H and I don't know, U and V. It doesn't matter, with no big loss of generality. So it's a generalization of the derivative, so maybe it's a good idea to remind ourselves what is the derivative. Derivative, we have seen it as a particular case of the function from R to R, right? And of course, in this case, we don't deal only with linear functions, which, remember, are extremely simple functions of this type. Straight line that pass by zero. Remember, it's very important. If the function doesn't pass by zero, it's not linear anymore. It is affine. It is a line, but the fact that it's displaced, this gap, is breaking its linearity. So from R to R, linear functions are very simple. So we've been working a lot with non-linear functions. From N to M, we have seen, I think I have convinced you of that, that it was not so straightforward to deal with linear functions, because there is a lot of concept, concept of eigenvector, for instance, or concept of the inverse of the functions, and adhering to matrices, the composition, bringing this story of products of matrices, the application of the function on one variable brings us the product of the matrix with the vector. So we spent many lectures on describing these linear functions. So today we are going to describe non-linear multivariable functions. And that brings us to an entire field of calculus, which is the multivariable calculus, function of several variables, meaning usually they are non-linear. So as I said, let's remind ourselves what is the derivative of a non-linear function. And let me put two examples here of a non-linear function. Well, the sine, for instance, is non-linear. It's roughly linear, remember, it's important, it's roughly linear there. That's Taylor expansion, sine of x is x plus something else. But if you look a bit farther, then it's not linear. So if I look at this point here, at this point x naught, for instance, I would see that my function is not linear, is curved. So we can linearize it, we can approximate it by a linear function with this concept of derivative, which is at x naught is the ratio of how much the function is changing. This you know already, yeah? How much the function is changing when I make a little deviation around the point around which I'm looking. So here I'm looking around zero. I make a little epsilon step on the left or on the right, and how much the numerator is changing as compared to the denominator. Yeah, so this is this concept of the tangent. It's delta y over delta x. That's the tangent of this angle. And as well, you remember, if we wanted to be accurate, which we should want to be, of course, this is correct, this is exact in the limit when epsilon goes to zero. So that's the definition of derivative. How would we do this for a function which takes a variable that has dimension n and takes its value itself, the function in codomain, it has dimension m? How do we generalize that? So for a little while, actually, we can not read too much about this m. Here we can take m equal 1 to work from functions that have several variables, but they take the values, which is one number. Okay, so it's a function of, let me give you an example, of 2D function, for instance, from R2 to R. So from xy, it could take the value, I don't know, exponential minus x squared plus y squared, the Gaussian in 2D. So you know the Gaussian in 1D. Yeah, x, that's exponential minus x squared, bell-shaped, in 2D, so here we could write it as well, because r squared is x squared plus y squared, Pythagoras, we could write it in terms of only the radial vector, in which case you see that in 2D, this is the function which has this polar symmetry, so it's not easy to draw. As usual, I will ask the computer to help me to plot you, to show you a properly plotted functions of two variables that takes here one value. So that's the z-axis here in 3D, x, y, z. The z-axis is the value that the function takes. So this function we can graph. yeah, because they live in the 3D, in the 3D space, and 3D space, well, in principle, we can visualize it. If you have a function from R2 to R2, which is the case of complex valued function, for instance, yeah, because you've got x real part and y imaginary part, and if the function itself is complex valued, then I need z, which is also has a real and imaginary part. So I would plot that in a four-dimensional space, and that brings us some problems because we cannot visualize functions in 4D. Let alone functions that take n-dimensional vectors and as the variable, and they take their values in a space of dimension m. This we can't start to visualize. So we need to recourse to tricks. For complex valued functions, you will see tricks when you do more complex analysis next year. But for now, we can use this as an example, yeah, as an illustration of the concept that we are going to use. Let me give you another example of such a function. It could be, for instance, x plus y, x minus y. This one is nice because it is the saddle function, something like this. Yeah? So it's maybe even more difficult to plot, but you can visualize it easily because this is precisely the saddle of the horse. That's why it's called the saddle function. It has a nice property that we are going to see when we look at this concept of derivative for the multivariable functions. So, if we come back to the derivative, how would we define the derivative of such a thing? So, we'd be tempted to do something like this. Yeah, let's say that my xy, I would write it as a vector, because this is a vector, right? Any x and y defines a vector, namely this vector. So I could say that if I make a little epsilon step, so I've got my vector r in the space xy, and I make a little epsilon step around. Yeah, so a little epsilon like this. Maybe in this direction, it's 2D now. It would be pointing in n-dimensional space. It's very small, but the direction could be anywhere. In which case, the vector that I'm looking at are this vector, yeah, by the parallelogram law. I'm exploring around my point, which is so far the good concept of the derivative. Yeah, but then, so let's try to generalize, like brutes. We'll take the limit when the vector goes to zero. This we could maybe also define the limit of the epsilon vector goes to zero. It would mean basically that its modulus goes to zero. But we should as well worry about the direction to which it will reach zero. And actually that would be a concern when we look at calculus or infinitesimal calculus of multivariable functions. But let's carry on with our program and try to define the thing like this. So that would be the f prime at r. So I want this variable there, actually, that would be the derivative as r. So I'm exploring around and I'm seeing how my functions vary when I change the epsilon. Here I'm taking the real valued function. Actually, if we would be tempted to do it in Rk, and this would be a vector, we could define the difference of the vector, no problem. Yeah. So far for the numerator, we don't have a problem. The problem that we have actually is here, when we divide by the epsilon. This is a problem because we didn't introduce this concept of dividing by by vector. Division, you remember, was our algebra lecture. It's not a property, it's not an operation per se. This is the multiplication by the inverse, and the inverse is a counterpart, is the object that if I multiply it by one quantity, I get the neutral element of our field, of our set of numbers. So the inverse is a derived notion. What is really important to define the inverse is the multiplication. But we didn't introduce any multiplication of vectors. Yeah, if you've got two vectors u and v, okay, so sure enough, you define the scalar product. Scalar product is not a product of vector. It's a type of product, but that makes a scalar, a proper product of two objects, should give an object of the same kind. Although, yeah, 3 times 2 is 6. It's not that I'm transforming 3 and 2 into a color, into something else. Yeah? I get two numbers, and I by multiplying them, I obtain another number in the same set. So this is not, even though it's called product, well, we insist very much, it's called scalar product. So to remind ourselves, it's a special type of product. It's more scalar than a product, actually. We also define the vector product. So the vector product is only for geometrical vectors to start with. And this one defines a vector. fine. But it's also not a proper product for the type of operation we would like to do. Yeah, it would be difficult to find. So I don't want to enter into the complications there. It's something that we should discuss in the algebra lecture. The point is we don't have any notion of an inverse vector U like this. Yeah? We have of the matrix, but it's in very particular sense for the matrix. Yeah? For the matrix, you remember in particular, it has to be for the square matrix, okay? Because it corresponds to the inverse in the sense of composition of function. So even though I would be tempted to see a vector as a particular case of a matrix, this vector can only be square. If it's square, the vector, then it has one element. A vector with one element is a square matrix, so to speak. And for this, I could define an inverse. That's true. Yeah, that would be one object, one component vector, which component is the inverse itself, and I can define that. So, well, maybe a long discussion to say one thing, that we don't have this operation. This is not defined. So here, I should put a big integration point, or maybe an exclamation point, like in chess notation, to say what is going on. I don't understand. So the good way to look at it, actually, is not to write the derivative in a way that let intervenes this ratio of how much the function is changing when I change the variable. It's good for one variable function, but for multivariable function, it's better to look at it in this way, to say that when we change the function, we change it by little epsilon, then we get the following, f prime of x epsilon. That's the first order, and then we even see in Taylor that we could do things like this. Epsilon squared divided by 2 plus op. Anyway, so the derivative is there, okay? So that's where the Jacobian enters, because we can generalize. Actually, now we'll do it from a general function that goes from n to m. So I would write here a vector to remind ourselves that our function itself in its codomain is a vector. So we've got x that belongs in Rn, and f of x is in Rm. I'll try to distinguish my n and my m. Okay, so I can define this, yeah, for both x and epsilon in two vectors of n dimension. And this is well defined. Now, if you look at it, I could define it, provided that, so I will stop at the first order, I will tell you why in a second, and I will introduce here this object that I call the Jacobian, in honor of Jacob Jacobi there. Carl was the first name, was the real first name, but he's full of Jacob otherwise. So I will call it the Jacobian of f, evaluated at x, and then I multiply by epsilon. So let's see what kind of object this Jacobian is. Yeah? Here we have no hope of defining epsilon, but here maybe there is a hope of defining this object. So here, this thing, I will write in a different color, this belongs to Rm. We are in the codomain of the function. This one on the other end, on the opposite, belongs to Rn. We are in the domain of the function. So if I want to add to something which is in Rm, this quantity which takes as an input an object which is in Rn, what is this thing? It's something that brings us from a n value vector to the m value 1. Yeah, so that I can add it to this one. What kind of object is that? It is a matrix. So the Jacobian is a matrix. Is a matrix of which dimension? Is a matrix of dimension n, m times n. Yeah? Namely, it would have, let me put my epsilon there. So it's epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon n, n components, because we are in Rn. And our matrix here should have n columns. Yeah, because remember the product matrix, I would write the matrix in this color. So I would get, I would call it G. So I would get G11, G12, G1n, because the product, it will return something, which is the object that I will add to this f of x. So it needs to have n row this time. The product is like this, if you remember, the way that matrices make their product. Yeah, I go horizontally, I cannot do it like this, horizontally on the left and vertically on the right, something like this, okay? I'm never sure if it's entirely clear when I do this. Okay, and how many rows do we have? How many rows? Well, clearly, m rows, yeah? Because M rules, because, so M1, Mn. So this one gives us the dimension of the object. Yeah, this is indeed M row N column, which is what I wrote there. It has M row because, as I said, I should add it, that's the plus there, I should add this object to f of x, which is in our M. So here I've got M row, yeah, I've got 1 M. Okay, so it's M times N object. Which object is that? Meaning, what are its components? What is G11, GKL, so on and so forth? Well, to do that, we'll take one little step backward and look at a simpler, more usual definition of the derivative, which is to look at function of xy. We'll come back to R2 to R, but it's easily generalized. So I'll draw it like this. Is a function that to xy associate the function at x and y. We can say, okay, this function that has two variables, we will vary only one variable, and we'll take, so let's say x. X will be a real variable. And the other y, we'll take it like as a constant, we'll pin it. So if we look again at our 3D representation of our 2D thing, so x, y, and z, and to fix idea, you could imagine, for instance, that this is the landscape of a mountain, and you have a little hiker there, and the function is the altitude, for instance, the height of the mountain. Yeah. So you are following the path, and then you are looking what is your height, depending on your x and y position. Okay. So let's say that the road which is bringing you around the mountain, it is horizontal to the y direction. It doesn't move on the y direction. Yeah? So you are following it like this, and on this particular step of the track, y is constant. So you are only moving. Actually, no. Here it looks like x is constant. So let's take this detour when we are moving like this. Okay, like this. We are starting there. The car. We left the car there, and we are starting like this. Yeah, and then like this. Okay, that's the trajectory. So this I can call it the trajectory, which is a function of x and y. Okay, so we are starting there at the beginning, and this is parallel with x, more or less, meaning it's also perpendicular with y. Therefore y doesn't change. Yeah? So we are at this given y as we move there at the beginning. So we move y, and we're asking how much is the steepness, how much is the change of the altitude of our functions f when I'm changing x, given that y is constant itself. In general, I'm interested of how much is changing when I change both x and y, but we are going to that. First, we start to pin to stuck one variable. So this is precisely the function that we know already of the normal derivative, yeah? Because we change x by little delta x or epsilon x, we keep y constant, and then we look, so that's the definition of the derivative, we look how much the altitude or the function is changing when I'm changing the variable. The only variable that I allow myself to change, which is this x, keeping this y constant. So if I take the limit when epsilon goes to zero, epsilon x, this is indeed a notion of a derivative, a familiar one. Yeah, because this is the 1D. Here we can make the ratio as we did before. So this, we have a name and we have a funny notation for that. So the notation is important. We call it the partial derivative, and we write it like this. So instead of using this d or this prime or whatever, we use this this sign, which, to the best of my knowledge, is one of the rare instances where a mathematical notion has its own letter of the alphabet, its own symbol. Actually, we'll see another example in a little while. But there are very few. Usually, we take symbols from other alphabets or from other places that we know. Yeah? So this is very rare that we have symbols that are used only for that. To my knowledge, it's not used for anything else, this partial, except that for the mathematical needs. Either this one exactly, partial, so it's called partial derivative, or things that are associated, like contours and this kind of thing. Okay, so very importantly, this partial derivative, the same way that the derivative of the single-valued, single-variable function was itself a function, the partial derivative is a function of x and y, right? So this could be a bit confusing, yeah? We need to take example. this is a function of x and y, because this is at this point here, for instance, red, I am at this point x, y. I'm looking at this point. When I don't change y, I'm perpendicular to y, so I'm not changing y. When I change x, how much is the function changing? But this I could do at any over x, y of the plane, yeah? But in principle, you can go everywhere. You could go there, 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 and there. The altitude will be different, and if you move only in the x direction, yeah, you will find that. So to do that, maybe you have to go off track if you climb the mountain, and you will see that it's very steep. Precisely, that's why that would bring you off track if we insist at looking at the partial derivative. So clearly, we can do the same, but fixing x, in which case we speak of the partial derivative, I will write it in red, the partial derivative for the y variable. Yeah, so it's also a function of xy, and this is defined by this time looking at the variation when I'm changing, making a little step in the y direction. Yeah, so at this point, I can look either in blue. I can look at the steepness when I'm going there, or in red at the steepness when I'm looking there, and it looks like that it would be much more steep in this direction in my sketch. Yeah, but let's take the example. For example, the function xy, which was the Gaussian exponential minus x squared plus y squared as before. So we can define the derivative, the partial derivative of x. So I'm assuming that y is constant. I'm the differentiating for x. So what is the derivative of this? Is minus 2x exponential minus x squared plus y squared. Why? Because this is constant. Right? So practice this partial derivative. They are just exercises. They are very good to consolidate your knowledge and skills with the partial derivative. Could do the same with the y. Yeah, this is by symmetry. We don't even have to compute. We can just substitute. Is this. Yeah? So it tells you at a given point of your Gaussian, if you are, for instance, there, if you are there, if you take a little step in x, how much you experience steepness in the x direction. And if you make a little step in y, how much you experience steepness in this direction. And for all the points x, y. Yeah? So the variables appear in different places, but they have different roles. Here is to mean that you have fixed y and you are varying x, and here is to mean where we are in x and y. Okay, very good. Now, as I said, what we are interested in is not when I make a little step in X or a little step in Y. This is a bit arbitrary, especially if you are hiking. Yeah, there is no Cartesian reference in principle. You are interested when you make a little step in any directions. Yeah, maybe particularly the directions of the path, of the track. Or if you want to go off track in the direction that you choose to go. Yeah, maybe you want to cut and not follow the track, but go there, what would be the steepness if you go anywhere? Yeah? Okay, so for this, we can look at this thing, which I will call it delta F. This is what happens when I make both now a little change in X and Y. Okay, so by definition, that would be definition. I'm looking how much the function is changing as compared to where I am. So I'm starting at xy. I'm making a little step epsilon x. I'm making a little step epsilon y. So maybe epsilon x and epsilon y, they will all be very small. They're infinitesimal. I will take the limit goes to zero. But maybe they go to zero not at the same speed. Maybe epsilon x is going to zero faster than epsilon y, which means that I'm looking not in the diagonal of x and y, but something which is closer to x, or vice versa. And it's completely general. So here, what I can do without breaking the equal is to add this quantity and to subtract it, because if I add and subtract, I did nothing. And then we rearrange, so that's the oldest trick in the book. We rearrange like this. I will duplicate and rearrange. So we've got an equal sign there that links these two lines. I will do it like this, for instance. We'll put these two guys together. You go there, but not with the minus. And there was a minus of this one, which I will put this one with this guy. Okay? So I just moved it around. So the equal sign still stands. Now, I'll do the same. I add and I'm writing it everything again so that it will convince you that maybe it's faster to actually go through the ordeal of duplicating this expression. So this one I will divide by delta y and multiply by delta y. So same thing, I multiply and divide by the quantity, so multiply by 1, so I don't change it. And the other, so this one, let's duplicate it. The other one, I will do the same, but as you can see, with delta x. Why? Because now, when delta x is very small, if I take the limit when delta x go to 0, well, this df will tend towards a differential, so I will call it df at the end. And here, this df is equal to, so this one is particularly clear. Yeah, this one, by definition, this delta x, I've got y which is not moving, is fixed, and I'm looking at the rate of change of my x variable when I'm making a little step here. So I called it epsilon x, which is not a good name. I should have write it d delta everywhere. Yeah, delta. I've been using two notations for the same quantity, delta x. Okay. Not very consistent, but okay, we can catch ourselves falling in track, and now we've got this. So this one I said is particularly clear in the limit where delta x goes to zero. It's exactly the definition that we have introduced there. So this is the partial derivative. This is the partial derivative as function to x, because I'm changing x. And I'm multiplying by this delta x, which in the limit when everything goes to zero is dx. The other one is not so straightforward, because I am around x plus delta x y divided by dy dy. And here I kept this little guy there. Yeah, but that's just a distraction, because this quantity df dy x plus delta x y, we can expand it around delta x, so we can take the function itself at x, y, and say that the deviation, due to this little thing, is the derivative as compared to x of these functions. So of course I can take, because they're functions of x and y, I can take the derivative of the derivative. I can iterate these things. Yeah? We speak of higher order partial derivative. So I've got dx, dy at x, y multiplied by delta x. Okay? And in the limit where dx goes to zero, assuming that this quantity is finite, doesn't diverge, which would be the case for most well-behaved functions. Otherwise, we have to be careful to demonstrate this properly. But I'm not interested in the demonstration here. I'm more interested in convincing you, or making you feel how these things come about. So this will go to zero, yeah, because here we'll get, when we take the limit there, we'll get a dy dx. And that that goes to zero faster than this quantity, and therefore what we get is the result is that we retain this term here, and this term is just removing this delta x. So that's what we want. So that's the result which I want. That's the important one, and that will be the foundation for our Jacobian. We put the box there. How did we get stuck with this horrible color? We put the red box around this horrible blue. So it tells us, I've got xy here as well, if I wanted to put it everywhere, I've got xy. So usually we would not write it like this. Huh? We would write it, maybe let me write it again more conventionally with a better color, so we'll remove the red box there. And using the notation which is more conventional, which is to say that it's df dy, so this is notation for the function, so we put this outside of the function, dy plus df dx xy dx, and we would put x before y, and we wouldn't, so most of the time we don't put this, yeah, because it is implied, or we remember that partial derivative is a function, so we don't need to put this. So the real familiar way that you will find it return all the places around is like this, is df dx dx plus df dy dy. And this one, indeed, you can put a red box, because that's the form you will find everywhere. It shows you that this we call an exact or total differential, right? And this we call partial derivative. So total differential and partial derivative. Okay, so it tells you that if you take a little step in the x direction and in the y direction, then the function is changing as a combination, a superposition, a sum. It combines the this change weighted by the steepness, by the rate of change in the respective direction. And this is really intuitive. If you think about it, this expression is extremely physical. It makes a lot of physical sense. Because if this is very steep, then a small delta x step here will cause you a big change. While if this is very small, then even a fairly large step here will have a small change of the function. Note that this could be negative, of course, this quantity, meaning that the functions decrease. Yeah, when you go forward, when you go on your track, then you go down. Yeah, you low altitude. Something you are familiar with if you are hiking. Yeah, it can go up, down, it can be steep, can be not steep. Okay, so here we introduce this quantity. So I was telling you of this symbol that we only use for mass. So this one is also something that that we don't find often, I believe, outside of the mathematical context. But this is merely the upside down delta of the Greek uppercase letter. Yeah, so we've got delta lowercase, big delta. If you put this upside down, then you've got this, which we called nabla. 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 So what is nabla? It's a symbol for something which is important. Nabla, it's a vector, so sometimes we put the arrow to remember this. It's the vector of the partial derivative. So we write it like this. So nabla is an operator, meaning that we need to feed it a function like f. Put the function f. This is a vector. It follows the intuitive rules of linear algebra, so we can put the function inside. Okay, so this is the, now it's a vector. Okay, it's the vector of the partial derivative. And we call that, it has a name, the nabla on the function. We call that the, it's a name that you have heard and you have misused actually, the gradient. Gradient. So this is the name for this thing, is the gradient. So the gradient is a field as well. Yeah, I can put parentheses. It's a field, it means, I don't think we need to use this concept of field. Well, field in physics, it means it's a function of several variables. Yeah. So it's a field because it depends what I want to say. By if it's a field, I want to say that it depends on x and y. Why? Because if you look at how it's defined, here we've got x and y. Right? We said the partial derivative, they are functions. It depends on x and y. So because they do, then of course the object that they define also depends on the same way. So the gradient is a function. That's in 2D. We also have the same in n dimensions, yeah? So in 3D in particular, the gradient is d over dx, d over dy, d over dz. Same thing, we need to put a function this time of three variables, x, y, z, or we could put it in Rn. And it's a vector, yeah? So it tells you actually the gradient, it points you, it gives you the vector is pointing towards the steepest ascent. Yeah? If it's negative, the steepest descent. It's telling you where you will switch if you want to climb, or where the rock will fall if you follow the if it falls, if it follows the directions. So it's very useful, of course, because it's pointing at the strongest change, the gradient. In terms of the gradient, so now we can do something very nice. Remember, in mathematics, we generalize, we extend, we take the new tools we have and we apply to them the old rules of algebra, of arithmetic, of whatever that we have. So this thing here in this red box, we can write it like this. We can write it at df is the scalar product of the gradient of f with dr or d epsilon. Yeah, this I can put a box. So here we've got df over dx, df over dy in 2D, scalar product of dx dy, that would be my dr vector. And the rule of scalar product, remember, is the sum of the pairwise product. So this is indeed df dx dx plus df dy dy. Okay, that's what we had written there. Very good. So this thing, I can use it. That's what, it's in this sense, it is the foundation for everything I will be speaking about. To integrate it, don't try to use the laser, it will disappear. To integrate it between a point r and r plus epsilon df. So by definition, it will be f at r plus epsilon minus f of r, and then this is equal to the integral of my gradient of f times d dr between r and r plus epsilon. Okay, and actually I will take epsilon so small, very small, because I want to link it to my Jacobian, to the derivative for the n variable functions, that I will assume that my gradient doesn't vary. Yeah, it stays constant locally. Gradient is a smooth function, it's continuous. So actually I will neglect, I will make this approximation. So here we are doing math more like a physicist than a mathematician, because mathematician would have to be much more careful in defining things. So I've got the scalar product with my integral, I put the gradient outside, assuming it's constant around r, and this is r plus epsilon minus r, so this is epsilon. Okay, so what we have, I bring the things together, is this is equal to the gradient of f evaluated at r times epsilon. So this is to tell you that according to, if I put the sign on the other part, according to our previous definition, this is essentially our Jacobian of f. Okay, there is actually a difference the way we define it. There's two differences. One is not a big deal, we are going to look at it right now, and the other is a bit more subtle. So the first difference is that we work with Rn to Rm, and right now I don't know if I made it clear when I came back under the assumption that we are in R. So we have actually, when you are working with xy in value of R. For the general case, we want to have n and m. So it will be easy to come back to n. It will not be very difficult to come back to m. Yeah, but I'm showing you now. The most important is that, well, when we put this thing here, it looks like it's a scalar product, but this is not a vector. So actually, when I put this dot, I should be careful. This dot is certainly not good practice. It's better to write it like this and to see it as a matrix product. So to understand this vector as the result of a matrix times a vector. This vector as the result of a matrix times a vector. Therefore, now this thing here, which is really a vector, the gradient is a vector. I want to turn it into, I want to turn this scalar product between a real vector and a vector into a matrix product between something that is related to the gradient and a vector. So here I've got the matrix product. Then the way I do this is that I have to transform my column vector, the gradient, into a matrix row, something like this. So I have to take the transpose of my gradient. I don't know where I have the thing here, because I said that we are in R1. So this is the transpose of the gradient. Yeah. So our GF at R is DF over DX, DF over DY. And we are at XY. XY is the notation for R at XY. Okay. So that's our Jacobian. That's almost the definition. So we said we want to be from Rn, not R2, to Rm, not R1. So Rn, it's easy. It means that instead of taking the to stop at x, well, I can collect x1, x2, xn. So we have this component. dxn. This is easy to generalize. The fact that we go to Rm is not much more difficult. We can do it very easily. In the codomain, we can just consider that here we've got a function f that goes to Rm, which is, let me copy it to have room because a lot is coming, which is composed, yeah, so to x1, xn, we are mapping to a vector which is composed of m functions of single variable. So it's x1, xn, x1, xn. Okay, so this is n in Rn, and this is m in Rm. And any of these functions, f1, fk, fm, any of these functions is a function of n variable into R. So this is what we've done there. Therefore, we can pack them like this in our final result. We can pack them in different rows. So what we get, that's the final thing, and that's our promised Jacobian of dimension m times n. This is this matrix, that's the Jacobian. That's df1 here. Actually, let me duplicate because it's really related. I will duplicate three times. Maybe I should move it because it's a big Jacobian, is a big thing. Okay. Let's leave a bit of room. So it's n like this. Okay. And the last one we could make room to say that this goes like this. Then we got the diagonal. So what do we need to change there? We need to change the functions. The variables are correct. We just apply it to the several function f1, fm. So we put it in this color. We've got f1, f2, fm. F1, f2, fm. F1, f2, fm. And as usual, we've got here the dimension of m, of our matrix. M times n. This is, remember, so that's the important object of today, that's the Jacobian of F. It would be evaluated, I will put the definition, it would be evaluated at the point R, which is there, because remember, all the partial derivatives are functions. Yeah? So this R is everywhere. Not putting it everywhere, but you know it's everywhere, the R. So on and so forth. That's our Jacobian. Why we worry about the Jacobian? Because it is the central object to do something which is really important, which you have certainly heard about under the name of the chain rule. So the chain rule is to do, Jacobian is linear, it's a linear approximation to have to our non-linear function. Now remember, we are working with functions from Rn to Rm that are non-linear. But we can locally approximate it by a linear application. So that's the beauty of the Jacobian. It's like the line in 1D that approximates our function by its slope, by its tangent. Here we've got the tangent, or the linear approximation by a matrix, therefore, because it's linear, to our function. And when we compose functions, so when we've got things like this, we've got a function that goes from Rn to Rm, first function g, and then we take another function from Rm to Rl, so for free integer n, ml. If we know the Jacobian of this function, and we know the Jacobian of this function, so this is a matrix m times n, and this one is a matrix l times m, then we would be interested in the composite non-linear function this time, that goes directly from Rn to Rl, and I can call it, I don't know, big F, for instance. So big F is F composite of G. So this has a Jacobian, GF, which is GF, G, GF, G. The question is, what is the relationship between these three objects, between this Jacobian of this composite function, direct function, this one, and this one? What is it? It's very important because it's at the heart of things like the change of variable. Yeah, let me give you an example. If you've got from R2 again to R2, and then here we can take Rk, Rl, whatever, but we can work in R because it's the same. It would apply to different columns of the same function. I would take F, don't try it with the rubber, F, J, and let's say that we've got, I don't know, R and theta, and that brings us to X, which is R cos theta, and Y, which is R sine theta, into XY. And then we've got the function here of XY. So when you work in Cartesian coordinates, f of xy, sometimes you prefer to work in a polar coordinate because your problem has this symmetry, for instance. It doesn't depend on the angle. Yeah, like our Gaussian of before, it only depends on the distance from some center, in which case it's much better to work with this. Your differential equation, instead of being a differential equation with two variables, which brings you this concept of partial differential equation. Next lecture, not the real lecture, the Christmas lecture, but there we discuss a little bit partial differential equation. Well, if it has polar symmetry, actually it's an ordinary differential equation, which is much simpler. So we would work with this, but to work with this, we need to change the variable. So we need to go from R theta to... So for convenience, we would write it like this. r theta. But it's a different function, yeah, because the first dot giving its value and the second dot giving its value will give you a different number if you are there or there, yeah, because the x projection is not the same as the distance, and the y projection is not the same as the angle. So actually, it's much safer to use a different name, but hopefully one which is related, like big F, for instance, yeah, that goes from r theta directly to big to the value of the function. Yeah, so f of r theta is what happens when you are parameterizing your functions in terms of polar coordinates. This problem is very natural, and we could formulate it as well for this hiker. Where is it? Our little guy who left the car at the beginning, at the bottom of the mountain. Here it is. Yeah? You could say that he's going through this trajectory, yeah, as a function of time, for instance. Yeah? So you've got time brings you to a given position. Yeah, this we could call the trajectory. And then you are interested in the altitude as a function of time. Yeah, the altitude as a function of time. So this you can obtain the altitude as a function of time by looking at the altitude of the position where it was at the given time. Yeah. And here it's clear that we will use this concept of partial derivative, right? Because if you are in a region where the steepness is huge, where it changes a lot, the gradient of our functions, but you go very slowly, it's about the same that if the gradient is small, it's almost flat, but you go very fast. Yeah, if you run on something which is changing very little, you will get the same deviation than if you go very slowly on something which is steep, right? So we'd be interested to know what would be the gradient or the change of the altitude as function of time. Yeah, what was for your speed or your work or your energy expenditure, you would compute this quantity. But you may have to pass by that. You need to worry about this relationship. So let's have a look at this relationship between the Jacobian or the derivative, the multivariable derivative of our nonlinear functions, of the composite function, and of the composing function. What is the relationship? So this is called the chain rule, and I will demonstrate it now by applying the definition for f. So like this, f takes our value in r2, so I will take these things, f of r plus epsilon by definition of the Jacobian is this times epsilon. So f was like that, so I can just substitute. I could have written that directly. So that's g of fj at r times epsilon. And this thing now, so I'm not writing them in the good order, maybe. These things, by definition of the composite of function, is fg at r plus epsilon. Yeah? And I will work on different tracks. So here I will expand g, so I will do it like that. If that would help, I would change the style of this. No, this is too ugly, this one, okay. And I will work on this function. So by definition of the Jacobian of g, yeah, this is the definition that I'm applying to this function. Very good. And now, so if we assume that this quantity is small, because the Jacobian is finite, it's a linear application, and all the elements are finite. But this could be small because these things being finite, I multiply them by infinitesimals. I can make it as small as I want by making it as small as I want. So by making the assumption that this is small, therefore this is small, then I can now expand for f. So I apply the definition of f, which is g of r, plus, I will refrain from putting the arrow there, plus definition of the Jacobian of f, this time evaluated where? At g of r, because that's at this point that we are looking, that's around this point that we are making the linear expansion, multiplied by this. Okay, so here I could put parentheses, maybe in a different color. Yeah. This guy is the small epsilon variation around this point, which is there, yeah, for f. Okay, let's see everything disappear. And this we can compare to what we had there. What we have there, which I can write as f of g of a, I'm expanding actually this side, plus g f g a epsilon. So if we compare these two things, yeah, they're equal everywhere, there is an equal there, there is an equal there, which is equal to there, even if I don't put it, it's there, yeah, they're all equal. Therefore, these two things are equal. Yeah, I can simplify this and this, and then I've got the relationship I want. It's true for all the epsilon, and if it's true for all the epsilon vector, it means it's true for the quantity that my epsilon is multiplying the thing. Yeah, so I've got g f g at a is equal, that's this one, is equal to this. I remove the epsilon because any epsilon I put there, it will be true. I didn't make any choice of epsilon, which means it's true for the quantity itself that are before the epsilon. So let's write the thing. It's the Jacobian evaluated at r times the Jacobian evaluated at r. Okay, so this is the important result that people know under the name of the chain rule. So if you've seen the chain rule, you've been given particular cases, and I will show you how the particular cases derive from the general case. Actually, we don't write the chain rule in such a fancy form. I mean, we don't put so much insistence on where the Jacobians are being evaluated, because usually it falls naturally, it comes naturally from what you are doing, from the variable. There is self-consistency in the way to write the chain rule that is not needed. So we write it like this. It makes it much simpler, and it's a beautiful result. Or as well, here there is something, I made a step which was a big step actually. Here, properly we add, okay, here we have a vector. Here we have a vector. And here we've got a matrix. So when I remove epsilon, what I'm left is a matrix. Yeah. When I've got, what I want to say is this, I've got a vector U. I multiply by a matrix B. So BU is a vector. If I multiply this vector BU to the matrix A, I feed it to the matrix A, it's the same than to say that I pass the vector U to the matrix AB. Okay? So the parentheses are like this. That's what I want to say. There is this associativity of the parentheses between the matrix and vector product. You can demonstrate it. If you are not convinced that it's true, you can demonstrate it actually by induction or by, I believe by induction is the same. Okay, so here this chain rule, which is written in the simpler, more concise form, it tells you that the composite of the Jacobian of composite function is the product of the Jacobian. It's very beautiful, very linear algebra in spirit. See, we are doing non-linear differential multivariable calculus. And at the end of the day, what do? Linear algebra. So I told you, linear algebra, very powerful, is everywhere. It's very important to understand this. Yeah, you didn't cheat you when I told you to learn or to master your product of matrices. So it tells you that the Jacobians are obtained in this way. Let's look at examples. So for instance, let's look at this one. Come back to here. I want to copy that, sorry. So first a particular case or a couple of particular cases, and then I show you the general case. Okay, so we've got, I'll take a different color, this one. You've got the Jacobian G, which here a 2x2 matrix from R2 to R2. And here we've got the Jacobian of F, which is a 1x2 matrix. And here we've got the Jacobian of F, which is a Jacobian of F G, which is a 1x1 matrix. So what are the components? Let's write GJ. Remember, I'm French, and so for me it's difficult. This GJ, Jacobian of J. So by definition, this is dx dr, where x here we see it as the function. That's why we don't need to worry about putting where we evaluate the thing, yeah? Because all this falls naturally into place. So x is the function of r. When I write this here, what I really write, let me write it in this neutral color, I'm really writing x of r theta is, by definition, is r cos theta. X is a function of r and theta when I make the change of variable, yeah? And the same way, y is, by definition, a function of r and theta, okay? So I don't try here r theta. I could, but it's not needed. I can just write it like this, because we understand that x, if I change r and theta, my shell variable, I'm changing x and y, of course. I'm changing the direction, I'm changing the projection. This is clear, okay? So it simplifies the law. So this, the gradient on the, you remember it was the transpose of the gradient, so the gradient becomes the rho, so it's dx d theta, and then we've got the same for y. Dy dr, dy d theta. That's for gg. Let's write gf. So gf is a 1 times 2 matrix, so I've got 2 slots to fit. And f is the function that depends on x and y, so that's df dy. That's the gradient, that's the transpose of the gradient. Yeah, gf is literally the transpose of the gradient of f. And g of f, which is g of the composition, by definition, it's a 1 by 1 matrix, so I will put the parenthesis anyway, but it shows how... No, it's a, sorry, it's 1 times 2. 1 times 2 because we've got 2 there. So it's 1 times 2. I'll show you an example of 1 times 1 later. So this is df over dr and df over d theta. This is the transpose of the gradient of f as well. But keeping in mind that this gradient is in the r theta because it's in this domain. While this gradient here is in xy because it is in this domain. Okay, so it's a different gradient. When you do electromagnetism, maybe you will use things like this. You will put the variable to remind yourself of that. Anyway, so let's apply the chain rule now. So what we have is that gf is equal to gfgj. So it is this guy here, which is gf, is equal to g small f, which is this guy, times dj, which is a 2 by 2. So we are doing matrix products, eh? So it's coming kind of the unfamiliar order, because you are more used certainly at multiplying matrices by vectors. So here you are multiplying matrices with matrices. So it's the same, eh? We just must remember the rules, the good rules of algebra. Is it possible? This is impossible. Eh? I always drop something. Off you go. Okay. So this, if we expand it, we've got matrix products. We've got this guy here is equal to this, this, this. Yeah, we go horizontal, vertical. So this first element is this and this. So let's write it. We've got df over dr is df dx dx dr. That's this guy. Plus df dy dy dr. That's this guy. Yeah, like that. And the other one, which is this one, let's put some color if you want. We've got df over d theta is equal to df dx dx d theta, this one, plus, so I could put it like that, yeah. Plus what? Plus df dy dy d theta, which is this one. This one. This one. Yeah? Is it even correct or something? This plus this. Yeah. Okay. And this is the chain rule. So maybe if you've seen the chain rule before, certainly you have seen it in this way. Without the color, but that's all you have seen. In the sense that, I don't know how it's been explained to you, maybe in terms of little trees or little chain, and you see that indeed the function, the rate of change, or the partial derivative, when I change the variable r of my function f, to obtain this, I have to change the function f along x, and multiply this, or weight this, by the rate of change of x to r. Which again makes physical sense, huh? And to combine this with the same, but for wrong direction y. It's composition, so it makes extreme physical sense. The same for theta. I promise that I would give you an example from R2, for instance, where we've got the G, I will call it J here for consistency. We've got the GJ, which is 2 times 1. So F here is 1 times 2. So the point is that this big change that goes from R to R, why I want to show you this one? Because now the derivative will be, for the function R to R, this maps x, let's say t for instance, let's call it t instead of x, because t is a good variable which has one value, time, for the parameterization in terms of time. Yeah? So we've got the function of time is given if time is, that's the problem of our trajectory of our little Likert. Yeah? So f would be the altitude of before, is the opposite, xt, yt, yeah? Where you are in xy at a given time. Okay, so the altitude is given by where you are at a given time. That's natural way to compose functions. Okay, and there is a lot, and I will show you the arbitrary, the general way in a minute, but you can understand that you can go from R to R3, from R2 to R, passing by R3. It's a lot of possible combinations. Okay, and but most importantly, all these guys are all expressed in terms of this one. Yeah, can also put a red box around this one because that's the one you actually use. Even that, the other one that tells you where to take the Jacobian is more accurate. Okay, so this one, the important thing is that this Jacobian of F is a 1 times 1 matrix. So that's the one I said. We will keep the parenthesis to remind ourselves symmetric, but it's basically one number. What is number is the derivative. So instead of writing df over dt, for this one we will write directly df dt, or f prime of t. This is the standard derivative. It's the standard derivative which is obtained by transiting through the theory of calculus of several variables. Yeah, we transit from this thing, but at the end we have the final thing. So let's write very quickly gj. It's, so if we have x and y, we said that would be dx over dt and dy over dt. So this time it becomes our matrix becomes like a vector. More properly, it becomes a column matrix, one column matrix. Yeah, because we don't have the gradient, we only have one variable. And gf, this one is a gradient, so gf is df over dx, df over dy, because rdf takes one value depending on two. So this one is the gradient of f transpose. Okay, so we got that f prime of t, or I will write it instead as df over dt, is g f composite with g, therefore it's gf gg, which is the chain rule. Df is the gradient, df dx, df dy, with our vector, which was, remember, dx dt, dy dt. Yeah? It was there. Okay. And this 1 times 2 concatenated with this 2 times 1, remember the matrix product, this concatenate with this one, we are left with the outer one, which is 1 times 1, which is this guy, yeah, which is properly in one parenthesis. So we've got that df over dt is equal to df dx, chain rule, supernatural dx dt, plus df dy, df dy, dy dt, df dy, sorry, df dy. And actually, what we did for this, we could also do it for x and y, because x and y, they are here, x and y, they are a function of one variable. Yeah, it's x of t and y of t. Okay, therefore, this is really the straight derivative because there's only one variable. So we could write it like this. Okay, in which case we can also We can also, this is correct if you want it in this form, compute the derivative, but you can also simplify by the dt. Yeah. And this we have seen before, actually. We recover the result we've already seen before. This is how the total or exact differential depends on the derivative dx dy. Yeah. So this is the result that we already seen earlier. If we can find it quickly. Before applying the general chain rule, here it is. Yeah, that's this result there. Okay. So very familiar, and you see it's a particular case. All these things that you have seen maybe disconnected before, they all fit in particular case. Let me show you again, so very fast, the general result. The function from n to m, I will put f there actually and take g, because like this we always have the same. Doesn't matter where we put it, of course. We've got jg, jf, function f that goes from Rn to Rl directly. Let's put the dimensions. So here it will be m times n. The one will be l times m, and this one would be l times n. And by concatenation, our chain rule, which states that g f, which is g f g, is g f g g, we should have that l times n is equal to f is l times m, and the other is m times n, and the concatenation tells us that we keep at the outset l and n. Very good. So we just have to compute these values Jacobian. So here we would introduce a variable to make it easy. So we've got the vector t1, tn. Here we've got x1, xm. So each x1 is, let's zoom, and let's take a small pen. Each x1 is a function of the n variable t1, tn. You understand, yeah? t1, tn. Well, this one, I think, and this color. Okay, and here the same, so we've got, I can call z, z1, z, what? L. If we zoom, each z1 is a function of, what do you think? Is a function of x1, x, m, because we are m here. X1, xm. Here I'm not writing it, but this is the case. Each, let me write one just for fun. So z1, zk is x1, t1, tn. Then we've got x2, t1, tn. Then, comma, then xm, t1, tn, that's n, all right. For k, that goes between 1 and l, yeah? So when I change t, I'm changing all the x, and all these x are changing all the z, yeah? So it's lots of composition, it's a more general case. But in terms of the bookkeeping device, which is linear algebra and these matrices, then it's very easy because we write very simply. I will zoom out for a little while, and then we come back. So g, j, is the gradient of, so it's g, so the j is, we write it directly like this in terms of variable, the j are the x, so it's, don't write with the rubber, is dx1 dt1, dx1 dt2, dx1 dtn, because we've got this, and we can check, we'll write directly the last one, so this is dx, the last one, which is m, dt1, and here we've got dxm, dtn, and we can check this correct by looking at the dimension of our matrix. Yeah, the dimension of our matrix is such that this should be m times n, m times n, so indeed I've got n columns, and I've got m row, that's correct. So that's gj. So we can write gf, so we've got the gradient of f, so this is, I called it z, could call it f actually, it's don't really much introducing the z variable. So it's the variable for f or z are the x, so that's the gradient dz1 d like this, z1, so here you've got m, and here you've got dzl, dx1, you can put diagonal there, dzl, dzm, sorry, xm. And check that this should be L times M. Is it? Well, we've got M and L, it is. So we've got the last one to do, which is GF. And now we are derivating DZ1 with directly in terms of the initial variable, which are T. So it's DT1, DZ1 because the gradient, DTN. DZL, DT1, DZL, DTN, and that's LN. So the chain rules tells us that GF, which is GFGL, so we've got now, if we make the algebra of matrix product, we've got one element there, the kth row L column. I have to take the kth row of F, go like this, and multiply by the L row of J. Yeah? So that gives me something like this. Let's write the first one, the generic one, and that should be enough. So we've got DF or dz1, I write in terms of z1, dz1 dt1 is equal to, so I'm looking at this element, okay? So this should be this multiplied by this. I will get m there, m there, that's fine, that will work. So that's dz1, don't try to the laser, that's dz1 dx1 dx1 dt1 plus, and the last one will be dz1 dxm d dz1 dxm dxm dtn, and I don't have space, of course. I said dz, the last of g, fj, so dxm d T1. Okay, and the chain rule, so now let's come back to the full zoom. The chain rule is in this sense. That's how people remember it, I guess. We've got the T1 there, everywhere. And we've got the Z1 there, everywhere. And then we've got this thing that concatenate, that comes from the matrix product, yeah? Like this, like this. XX, so here there is this is X, yeah, of course, the same. Okay, so let's write the generic case. That would be the kth row L column K DTL. It would be the sum of DZK DX DXI II goes from, we'll see, from 1 to something, and DTL, okay, same as before, huh? Not putting the color again, but we've got the Z there, maybe it's a bit aggressive, this color, the TLA, and then we've got the concatenation inside. So this is going like this and like this in our matrix, so this is the M, is it the M? Yeah, this is the M. Don't write with the rubber. Okay, so that's the generic chain rule. Actually, it's kind of easy to remember. It's natural, at least. So you are strongly encouraged to remember it. I will just conclude with an application. Show you why it's important. It's important to change variables, as I told you. So let's look at this case. If you want, where we've got R2, J, R2 function f that goes to R, change of variable. Let's put a little title to this. Change, whoa. of variable. So if you've got here u v that goes to x y, that's f of x y, and we are interested to know as well about this big f of u v. So if we have x and y as a function of u and v, so we could write it like this, then we do exactly what I showed you. Then we multiply the Jacobian, then there's no problem. Then there's no need to do it, therefore. I want to show you actually that it's very powerful, this technique, and the algebra and the technique, the tools that we have learned and developed, they are very powerful to address the very recurring case, the very important situation, where we don't have x as a function of u and v and y as a function of u and v. What we have is u as a function of x and y, and v as a function of x and y. So to solve it the way I've shown you, which is to plot this graph there, the other way around, then we have to invert it like this. We have to first, if you got this equation, so if you got this equation, we have to revert it like that. Yeah. That could be complicated, if at all possible. Maybe it's implicit function, they have different solutions. It's locally, it's well defined, but overall, we cannot invert it, it's multi-values. Maybe it's a mess, maybe it's difficult to go like this. So the proper way to answer is to write it like that, starting from xy, go to uv. So how do we go from xy to uv? By, you go like this, right? So what is this thing? It's something that we know what it is. It's g minus 1, the composite. And the composite, it's, if we linearize the function, it's easy. The inverse of a composite function is the inverse matrix. That's beautiful, that's powerful, because we are dealing with Jacobians, which are linear applications, so matrices, so we can invert. Even though we are dealing with J is non-linear, so its inverse is non-linear, it's complicated, because we are going to take the Jacobian, so the linear application, we can actually easily invert it. That's why it's so powerful. And then here we go to, then here we need to put F to get the F of UV that we want. Yeah. Therefore, the function that we get there is F with G minus 1, but F itself was F and G, remember. So what we get here is F. Yeah? That's simply F. That brings us from, as it should, yeah? It brings us from xy to F of xy. Yeah? If you compare, we just inverted, let me zoom out to give some perspective, we invert this graph into this one. And then it's very easy to apply the chain rule there, because we've got G of F is equal to G of F G minus 1 is G F G G minus 1. We will want G F, so what we can do is multiply on both sides by the inverse of this Jacobian of this one, which will be therefore like this. We've got G F is G F G G minus 1 minus 1. Here we've got two inverse. Huh? Got the inverse of this Jacobian, which is obtained by this. So let's write what is DF. What is GF? GF is a 1 times 2 matrix. So it's something like this. GF is DF over DU, DF over DV, which is what we want in the first place. Huh? What I told you, it's the quantity we're interested. This is changing on this variable. The problem is that we don't know this. We only know this. So we'll be able to find this knowing only this. Then we've got GF. So GF is GF, which is this one, is 1 times 2 as well. And this is DF, DX, DF, DY. And what is G minus 1, so now I'm writing this one, I will write the Jacobian of G minus 1, which is 2 by 2, and this is, so let's copy this, that's the new element, so we'll go slightly slower with this one, G J minus 1 is DU dx du dy, sorry, du, the gradient, du Yeah, dy was correct. Dv dx dv dy. That's g j minus 1. We don't want g j minus 1, we want g j minus 1 minus 1. It's easy, we take the minus 1. Because we know how to take the inverse of a 2x2 matrix. Remember, we divide by the determinant. So there is a funny notation for the determinant. We write it like this. We also call it the Jacobian, by the way. It's quite confusing. So this is the determinant of this thing. So it's simply this. Du dx dv dy minus du dy dv dx. That's the determinant. Yeah? This minus this. But it's noted like that. It's also called the Jacobian, or actually you could call it the Jacobian determinant. And we have to swap the diagonal, so it becomes dv dy du dx, and we change the sign of the off diagonal. Remember that. Dv dx. Okay? So that's our matrix there. That I will not write again. Now we can easily obtain, so I again have to zoom out, I'm sorry. Df du, I'm looking at this guy, is equal to df dx times this guy times d. So what do we have here? Dv dy plus, we are looking at this one, so it's this times this plus this times this, so it's plus, because I zoom out, I'm writing a lot, so I put a parenthesis there. Plus, df, you're checking with me, you're following what I do, df dy dv dx. Okay, so let's come back, and we can actually, it's not that I write so big, I'm not a maniac, I zoom out so that I could, okay, and this we have to divide by the determinant of the Jacobian, which we already wrote, so we can get rid of the parentheses, we can copy it there, okay. Okay, so that's our relationship. So it's not an easy one, yeah? This you could not remember, for instance. The chain rule is fairly easy to remember, but this one is not easy to remember. In terms of the Jacobian, that it's straightforward, yeah? It would be even more straightforward if you look at particular case. Okay, I don't know how much time we have left. We are already over time. So very quickly, maybe I'll accelerate again. I'll show you the change of coordinate from polar to Cartesian, because this is so important. We'll do it in 2D, in electromagnetism, we'll do it as well with the 3D case. It's exactly the same, but instead of having XY, you have XYZ. Yeah? So you've got R theta, there I will start with R theta. And I will say that X is R cos theta, Y is R sine theta. So if I got a function F that goes, so that's F and J, therefore, let me change the name so that we don't overcome. So I've got a function that goes like this, r theta, and this is f of xy. So we've got, as always, gf, which is df dr df d theta. It's a 1 by 2 matrix, 1 by 2. Is equal to g gf, which is 1 by 2 as well, which is df dx df dy times the 2 by 2, this one, which is dj. And this one is interesting because that would be, this one we can compute, d dx dr dx d theta dy dr dy d theta, and this, as promised, we can compute. So if x is r cos theta, I differentiate for r, I get cos theta, I get minus r sine theta, y is r sine theta, so you have got sine theta, and you have got r cos theta. Okay. So we've got df over dx is, sorry, so we've got df over dr is df dx cos theta like this, plus df dy sine theta. And what I'm doing is that this guy is equal to this, this. And the other one is df d theta, so this one here is equal to this, this. Is df dx minus a sine theta plus df dy r cos theta. These are important, the other way around as well. We are not going to do all of them, of course. I leave it for you as exercise, as problems. But they are important to change from one reference frame to the other. Yeah. If you know how it's changing in x and y, sorry, then you know how it's changing in terms of r and theta. Maybe let me show you the second order case. If you would like to compute d2f over dr2, this is df. It's like this. It's a partial derivative function of r of df over dr. Df over dr we have just calculated now. So this is this one. We can substitute there. So we compute insofar as we can. So we've got this doesn't depend on, it's a product rule, but cos theta doesn't depend on r. So we've got cos theta d dr dx, so this we will call it like this, d square of f plus the same sine theta d square dr over dy. So now we've got this object that are mixing r and x. But as I told you, this is a function of x and y, so I can apply the chain rule just the same. Yeah, the point is that now we've got from R2 to R2, R theta. This is the same J as before. And now instead of F, what we get is D over DX. I could call it D over DZ, where Z is X or Y, because that would be basically the same. D over DZ, where Z is X or Y. F, and this goes to R, because our function F was single valued. So we've got the g, I could write it like this to win time, dzf, that's the Jacobian of this one, dj, we know already, the dj, what is the dj, that's dj, so we already calculated from before, and what we have to compute therefore is the Jacobian for this thing. So this is our function, dzf, so it's a 1 times 2, yeah, so we've got two thoughts, the gradient. So it's our function which is dzf. Okay, let's write it completely. Is d over dz. Z is x or y, remember. And then I have to take the first derivative from this guy. Yeah, so that would be dx. And here I've got dy, df, dz. Therefore, our Jacobian that goes there, it will be, so that's g dz f g is g dz f gg gj, and that's like this. That's, so let's compute, if you want, let's compute d, to fix idea, dx f j. So this is, it means that I've got x there now. So this is d2 dx2 f and dy dx dy dx f that I need to multiply by gj, which was, let's copy gj, where is gj? Gj is there. Okay. And this, okay, so this one I have to write as well. This is the one that brings us directly from there to there. Oops, I want to make a bit of room. So the one that brings us directly to dzfj it's also a 1 times 2 matrix, so this is D over dr of the function we had. So the function we had is d2 f d z, and here we got d2 d theta d z f, again z being x or y. And then so you see that we'll get the quantity that we wanted here, yeah, when we got this dr dx dr dy. Now we have them here, dr dx dr, we also have d theta, we want dr dx and dr dy for this one, because you are calculating the second derivative for r. If you calculate the second derivative for theta, which typically you will want as well, then we would need the theta. So it's calculating everything at the same time, huh? I don't think I'll calculate everything myself in the interest of time, but you see that if you carry on the calculation as is done in your notes as well, and as you should do for practice in the exercise, then you'll get everything that falls by itself. So we've got everything. So let's do the first one. Let's do this one, the top left component, which tells us, which is this one. I'll copy it there. We've got this is equal to the top left component. It would be, so it is this one times the other matrix. So it's like this times like this. So zooming out, it's d2f dx square cos theta plus d2 dy dx f sine theta. Okay, and then we've got d2f dr d, so this was dx, we want dy as well. So this was for dx. Okay, for dy, we would have, for dy we had the z there, so we would get dx dy and dy square. So I'll try to do it, so we'll get as well, I think it's also cos square sine. This one I'm doing a bit higher level, I'm substituting on the fly, so I'm not too sure it's correct, computer will tell us. But I think it's this, and then we would get d2f dx dy, and here I think we'll get d2f dy square. In which case, now we've got the two things that we wanted, and I'll try to complete it. Might be incorrect from this point onward, because I introduced this line, which is not completely sure, in the interest of time. But this, which was d2f dr squared, becomes cos square this quantity, which is there, cos theta, so it's cos theta square d2f dx squared plus cos theta sine theta d2f dy dx, which is this one. And then we've got plus sine theta, so now I'm doing the one which is not sure, sine theta with dr df dy, which is there, dr df dy, it's the one I used there actually, for the first one. Okay, go on, let me, now I know I made a mistake, so I can back up. So this is cos theta, this guy here, d2f dr dx, d2f dr dx. So we copy this one. That's cos theta, this thing, then I rearrange, plus sine theta dr dy, which I think, I'm not sure, but I believe, or I suppose, I feel, I sense, I hope, I guessed, is this one. Okay, and now, so what can we link? These guys are the same. Yeah. These two guys are the same, the other note. So in terms of the derivative, we've got dx square cos square theta plus df square sine squared theta. It's nicely symmetric, so it might just be correct. Plus d2f dx dy sine theta cos theta. 2. Looks like a perfect square. It looks like it's df dx cos theta plus df dy sine theta squared. Where the square on the derivative is not this square, is it should be written like this actually. Cos theta dx plus sine theta dy square. And the square and an operator, the square and an operator is understood not as taking the square of the function, because the function goes there, so the function is not square. What is square is the operator, and the square of the operator is just applying the operator twice. It's iterating. Is the square is the product in the matrix sense, which means repeated or iterated addition. So this is d2 dx squared. Might be, I'm not too sure. But if this is, well, then this is apparently d, this big f here, by the way. So this is d2 dr squared. Yeah, so the result we would get is this. Is it correct? I don't know. The computer will tell us. Okay, anyway, I will leave it there, even if the thing is not correct, because I jumped a bit, I tried to win time, we see our ring over time, but anyway, I'm not stealing you, because the principle is there, and what you have, the only thing you need to know is this, yeah, what is it, something which is in the red box, the chain rule, yeah, so once you know that, plus the definition of the Jacobian, then you can compute everything, from polar to Cartesian to cylindrical in 2D, or from one set of coordinates, one over in generalized space, whatever, you'll be doing this a lot. Okay, so that's it. We finish our 20 lectures. In class, when it's not remote, I like to do these things in 25 lectures. Okay, so but the lectures are 1 hour. Well, actually, you've seen that a few lectures are actually joined together. We typically go over 1 hour of time. So all the material you should see, you have seen, has been there. There is an additional lecture, as I told you, which is a bit more entertaining in character. I hope it will be shorter as well, where I want to give you a foretaste, an overview of all these things that you have seen now, multivariate calculus, but linear algebra, algebra, of course, very important, you must know the quadratic equation, how we will apply them in the future. And hopefully, this last lecture will give you the stamina, or at least justification, the moral support, to revise all this material, yeah, because that's very important to meet it. You'll meet it over and over again. You've seen already that within this lecture itself, in a self-consistent way, we have always came back to concepts we introduced before. Jacobians relies a lot on linear algebra is a lot on algebra. So it's kind of a self-contained ecosystem. Yeah? So don't ignore any part thinking that I don't care about analysis, I don't care about calculus, about algebra, about rhythmics. You need to know about everything, but it's helping, it's the strength of the thing. It's like the seven samurai, yeah? The union makes the force. So I see you for the next lecture, and have fun with our Jacobian.